God. The things that we celebrate, as you see on the postcard and the Pope, hope, the first week we celebrated hope, and we read some scripture, and we had a prayer, and we lit a candle, and then we spoke about love, and then we spoke about joy, and today we're going to talk about peace. And to help us with that, there's a special young lady who has just been fighting at the bit to come up here and tell us all about it. Her name is Cara Hall. Will you welcome her up here this morning?
Hear me? Okay. The Advent reading, week 4, peace. Hear God's promise of peace from the prophet Isaiah. Reading from Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 10 from the New Living Translation of the Bible. Out of the stump of David's family will grow a shoot, yes, a new branch bearing fruit from the old root, and the Spirit of the Lord will rest on him. The spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. He will delight in obeying the Lord. He will not judge by appearance, nor make a decision based on heresy. He will give justice to the poor and make fair decisions for the exploited. The earth will shake at the force of his word, and one breath from his mouth will destroy the wicked. In the day, the wolf and the lamb will live together. The leopard will lie down with the baby goat. The calf and the yearling will be safe with the lion, and the little child will lead them all. The cow will graze near the bear. The cub and the calf will lie down together. The lion will eat hay like a cow. The baby will play safe near the hole of a cobra. Yes, a little child will put his hand in the nest of deadly snakes without harm. Nothing will hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain. For as the waters fill the sea, so the earth will be filled with people who know the Lord. And that day, the heir of David's throne will be a banner of salvation to all the world. The nation will rally to him, and the land where he lives will be a glorious place. This is the reading of God's word for God's people. Watch and wait for Christ's coming. Light candles of hope, peace, joy, and love, remembering the promise of God with prayer.
The last purple candle.
We light this candle as a symbol of the Prince of Peace. May the visitation of your Holy Spirit, O God, make us ready for the coming of Jesus, our hope and joy. O come, Emmanuel. Let us pray. Faithful God, you are at work to restore all of creation in its intended harmony. Give us peace that we may be reconciled to all enemies in the peace that passes all understanding through Christ Jesus our Lord. God of promise, God of hope, into our darkness come. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Carla.
Thank you.
Celsius day, okay? The next week I forgot to take out. And that was from last week, but, you know, if I was perfect, you'd be here to see me, and if I'm not perfect, we're here to see the perfect Christ, okay?
Amen.
Okay. Well, once again this morning, I love the fact that you join us, and I know I say that often, but I truly, truly, truly do appreciate it, because I know there's so many different places you could be, there's so many different churches you could go, this time of year, there's so many different things that need to be done. Yet you took the time out to come here this morning and worship with us. And I believe that if you're here, there's a reason that you're here. Maybe there's a word of God you need. Maybe there's something in the singing you need to hear. Maybe there's somebody that's here that's going to say bye to you, and along the way they're going to say something that will impact you. But for whatever reason, I believe God has you here for a purpose. So, you know, maybe the reason is that we live in this hectic, this crazy world, and we just need to put our problems and our worries and anxieties aside for an hour and a half and just come into church and worship our Lord. Because, you know, I'll be the first to admit, my day starts early a lot of times. And my intention is, Lord, I want to spend a couple minutes with you, and the phone rings, and I'm off, and I'll do it in a few minutes, and then the next thing I know, the day's over. But I know when I come here, I know that on Tuesday mornings that we meet for prayer. I know that when I come here on Wednesday nights, I know when I come here on Sunday mornings that everything else can be put aside. Everything else can be put aside, and I can just take time and enjoy the fellowship of God's people. I can enjoy the fellowship of the Lord, and I can just rest in His peace. I can just rest in His joy. I can just rest in His love, and I can rest in His hope. And I don't have to be in control, because I can let Him be in control, you know? So like I mentioned earlier, I just think the week just goes better when we start off with meeting God and the fellow believers in His house. And I believe that because I've become so close friends with so many of you, that it's especially true here at the Odyssey Church, this local body of Christ. There was a letter that a man by the name of Paul, we call him the Apostle Paul, wrote to Christians in Rome. And it tells us many of the different reasons that God likes us to meet with fellow believers, why we should come to church. But one of the reasons he writes about, and he tells us not only should we meet, he said it's particularly important to bring those who don't believe. And he says this because he says, how will they call on Him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in Him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without somebody preaching? All right? So bring the people that you know, particularly those who aren't believers. That's why we created the Odyssey Church. For those who may be believers, or maybe those that are seeking, or for maybe those that have been hurt in other churches, or maybe those that have just given up because of their circumstances, so that they can receive and believe. Now, like I said, we're planning to end 2016 strong with the last worship trip of the year. That's going to be Saturday night on Christmas Eve, so I'd really appreciate for those of you who can. I know Christmas Eve is a tough time, but I also know, according to the research that not just me, but everybody seems to have put out there, that Christmas Eve is the second largest church event of the entire Christian year. Easter being number one, Christmas Eve being number two. And this year it's a family event. You know, if we have small infants, we'll find a way to take care of those. But this is a family event. So if you're meeting with your family or your family's visiting with you, bring them here. There's not going to be child care. We're going to worship together as families, as the family of God, and individually as families. So, you know, come out. Join the fun and the festivities. There's going to be a lot of singing, less preaching. I know that's a win for everybody, right? And there's going to be some food, cake in particular, you know. So that's a win for everybody. And I'm just looking forward to ending up this year strong. Now, according to my Weather Underground app, it is going to be beautiful. At 7 p.m., it's going to be 42 degrees, no wind, clear skies.
Amen.
Now, here's the amazing part, is it stays 42 degrees all the way up to 7 a.m. on Christmas Day, when it actually starts to get even warmer. This is going to be a beautiful Christmas Eve, all the way through Christmas morning, even into Christmas Eve, or even into Christmas Day. So, it's going to be cold at the beginning of the week, But that transforms the middle of the week and it starts to get warm again. So, it's a great night to come out and remember why we have Christmas. It's Christmas. There would be no Christmas without Christ. Amen. You can call it a holiday season if you want. You know, I don't get offended by that. But it is Christmas, and the reason it's Christmas is because of Christ. You take Christ out of it, it just must. So, anyway, if you're here for the first time, or the first time in a long time, I want you to know we've been in this series of messages on the hymns of Luke. And these particular hymns we've been looking at are found in just the first two chapters of Luke. We looked at the Magnificat, or Mary's song. We looked at the Benedictus, or Zechariah's song. We looked at the Nunc Dimittis, which is Simeon's song. And last week was really interesting, because we look at the Ave Maria. And the Ave Maria is most famously known as the prayer that's said with the rosary in the Catholic Church. But for those of you who are here, I think we had a great message with a lot of great hope. And even for our Catholic friends, I don't think anybody was offended. So if you missed those messages, you'd like to hear them again, or maybe you think some of your family like to hear them, you can always find them on our website, which is www.theodysseychurch.com. You can go to our YouTube channel. We got our own YouTube channel. It is the Odyssey Church. You put it in the search engine, we'll come up. You see a little picture of that little house, a little heart in it. Or the easiest way to do it, the simplest way to do it, is just download our app. And then you can watch it whenever or wherever you go. And if you have that non-believing friend, you just happen to have it on the radio, coming through the app, and who knows, maybe a life will be changed because they received and heard the preaching of the gospel. So the song we're exploring this morning, as you might already have figured out, is Glorious in Excelsis Deo. Or if you look into the Methodist hymnal, it's number 238, and it's Angels We Have Heard on High. So there's some evidence, and admittedly it's disputed, but there's some evidence that this was actually a song that was sung in first century church. That this song was sung 2,000 years ago. So isn't it pretty fascinating that today we're still singing the same hymns that those first century Christians were singing as they met and they gathered together? And of course, when it was first sung, it was sung in Latin. That's what the churches had. They had what's called the Latin Vulgate. It was a Latin translation of the Bible. And that's where all these names, these songs we've been studying, get their names from the Latin. And Excelsis Deo, the Magnificat, Nunc Dimittis, all of them. It comes from the Latin translation. We don't really know who wrote the song. I mean, I know that God inspired Luke to write these verses. I know that. But we don't know who the human author is who actually wrote the lyrics and the words, the Glorious in Excelsis, from the scriptures in which God inspired. We do know that it was first adopted by the French and translated into their language. And that's where we receive it. So a lot of times, if you look in a hymnal, it'll say that Gloria in Excelsis, or Angels on High, was a French traditional song. But it was really written in Latin first and then translated into French. But before we get started, this is I don't know if any of you remember Gary Larson and the Far Side cartoons. Gary Larson was one of my favorite cartoons. See, you had to have a weird sense of humor, but he was he was a smart man, and sometimes you really had to think about what he was saying. But this is one of my favorite cartoons. Now, I know you can't probably read the verbiage, but there's a man laying in bed, there's a woman laying in bed, and they're both thinking. It reminds me of me and Janet when I first met Janet. Janet's now my wife. I'm laying in bed and I'm wondering, I wonder if Janet knows I exist. Should I call her? Maybe she don't even know I exist. I'll call her. No, wait, I won't call her. I'm not even sure she knows it exists. Dang. And then there's Janet laying in bed. And she's going, you know, I think I really like vanilla. Same planet, different worlds. And isn't that the way it is sometimes? I mean, do you ever feel like that? I mean, you're going through something really tough, something really traumatic, and you meet a friend, and they're talking about how great things are, or the guy across the street is having a party, and you're on the same planet, but you're living in two completely different worlds. Or maybe you live on one side of town where all the rich people are, and they have their big houses, and they have their big cars, and their big checking accounts and bank accounts, and you're just a couple of miles away from them, and you're just struggling to make ends meet. You're living in poverty. Things are tough. Same planet, different worlds, and these two worlds really never seem to quite meet together. But as I watch the news, I see it's really, you know, so much worse than that. You know, we live in the United States, and no matter what your income level is, no matter how you're living, you still live better than most of the rest of the world. I mean, we're rich in every sense of the way when you compare ourselves to 95% of the rest of the people that live in this world. We live in a fairly secure and safe area. I mean, there are things that happen, but you know, when you watch the news, there's people who are living in poverty. There are people that are living with no freedom. They're living in war zones. They're living under these harsh dictatorships, and they don't know from day to day whether they're even going to live and make it through the night. You know, and we are on the same planet, but we're in different worlds. Well, 2,000 years ago, things weren't much different. The same thing was going on. There was a Roman emperor called Roman Augustus, and he gave the order for all the names of the people to be listed in the record books, a census. And it was probably for taxation purposes. It's much like every 10 years here in the United States, we take a census. That there's this decree or this official order that everybody had to go to their own hometown. The United States, when we take the Census Bureau comes to us. At this point in history, they had to go to the Census Bureau, and they had to go back to their hometown of the lineage that they were from. Not just their hometown, but the hometown of their lineage. And there was a man by the name of Joseph, and his bride was pregnant. Her name was Mary. And they live in Nazareth of Galilee, but they have to go to Judea in Bethlehem for this census. Joseph was from the lineage of King David. And even though King David had ruled 1,000 years before Joseph was even born, it was still David's hometown, and that's where he had to go back to. Now, Judea, Bethlehem, was 80 to 90 miles away, and Joseph's wife was 9 months pregnant. Now, it's hard for us men to relate to that. The best example I have is when my wife was pregnant, she did not even want to ride in a car for 80 miles. But this was a 2-week walk, approximately, through rocky terrain, through hilly mountains, through some dangerous territories, and the only way to get there was for her to walk or be on a horse or to be on a donkey, probably a donkey because of the terrain. And I can't even fathom. I've seen women that are 9 months pregnant. I've been with them. And I'm not sure if I felt more sorry for her or felt more sorry for Joseph, but it had to be a very difficult journey for her. So they get into Bethlehem, and when they get there, the town's packed because everybody that was from the lineage of David had to come into this town. And of course, it probably took, with his wife being 9 months pregnant, Joseph a little bit longer than most. So when they get there, there is absolutely no place for them to stay. Sort of like showing up in Ocean City on July 4th weekend with no reservations, and you're trying to find a hotel room. It just ain't going to happen. I remember Jan and I, when we were a lot younger, we had a thing that we used to do. We would take adventures. We would come to a stop sign, and literally we'd flip a coin. Right, you went left, and heads, you went right, and tails, you went left, and wherever the coin took us is where we ended up. Well, we ended up in the middle of a holiday weekend in right across the ferry in Atlantic City, and trying to find a hotel room, and the number of people that laughed at us, I don't even want to tell you. It was just nothing left. We ended up finding somebody who had two separate rooms that allowed us to rent half their room. It was a closet, basically. Oh. So this is sort of like Mary and Joseph. They get up there. There's nowhere for them to stay. You know, I'm sure that Joseph did everything he could to find a place to stay. But the Bible only says that there was no place for them at the inn. And sometimes the innkeeper gets a bad rap. But in reality, there just was no place for them to stay. So they settle down at the best place they can find, which is an animal stable. And they have this baby they were named Jesus, in the filth and the stench of basically a barnyard. And I'm sure, as you're aware of, that Jesus had been the promised Messiah. He was the Christ. He was the anointed of God. What you may not know, is Emperor Augustus, as Augustus was not the emperor's name. Augustus was his title. He was actually the adopted son of Julius Caesar. He was a man by the name of Octavius. And he took the name Caesar, which he was probably entitled to. The Senate of the time in Rome, they gave Octavius the titles like king. He gave him the title of emperor. They gave him the title of dictator. But none of that satisfied him. He chose the title Augustus. Now, Augustus had religious implications. It was this man's attempt, Octavian's attempt, to become God. So we have a man who was adopted into royalty, who became a king, who lived in luxury, who tried to make himself God. And then we have God, who was and is the King of Kings, who becomes a man and is born in poverty. I mean, what a contrast, right? Mm. There's an emperor who was a man who tried to make himself God, and then there's God who did, in fact, make himself man. See, in almost every other religion of the world, man is trying to reach up to God. But the reality is God reached down to man. And he did so. He came as we are, he was born as we are, he lived as we did. He did that so we could know him, not just know about him, so we could have a relationship with him, because he came in flesh and lived among us. God reached down and saved man. Now you got to think about this statement sometime. In effect, God sent God to save us from God. We're all worthy of God's wrath, but in his mercy and grace, God came to earth. God sent God to save us from God. So here's where we're going to pick up the story in the gospel, or the history of Jesus' life, and what we call the Gospel of Luke. We're going to look at chapter 2. We're going to begin in verse 8. So if you brought your Bibles, that's the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verse 8. And if you don't have a Bible, or you like the New Living Translation that I read from, there's some up by the door. Please feel free to take them as you leave. If there's none left and you haven't got one, let me see. Just see me after service. I got a few hidden around here somewhere. So anyway, Mary's in a stable with Joseph, and she's just given birth. And women, I want you to think about this. And men, you know, it's one of these things we can try to understand, but you ain't been through it. We ain't never going through it.
You ain't never
going
to
understand. But think about this. Mary's just given birth, and she has had no epidural. She's had no anesthesia. There's no sterilization. There's no midwife. There's just... Now, this might put in a reality for it. Can you imagine your husband or significant other trying to deliver a baby for the very first time? With nobody else around. You would probably send him somewhere. Honey, go boil some water or something. And when he got back, he would hope the baby was born so he wouldn't mess it up, right?
But she didn't know what she was doing either.
Yes, right. And she was only about 14 years old. But she takes what she could. She finds some strips of clothes. Some verses say swaddling clothes. They were strip of clothes. They wrapped the baby in. And this is the guy who's going to rule the world. He is God himself. And they lay him in a manger. And they think how chaotic that scene must have been. And then across town, there are these shepherds. And they're watching their sheep in the peace of the night air. You know, same planet, different worlds. That is up until now. And these two worlds are about to collide in the most amazing, in the most wonderful, in the most miraculous way. Scriptures tell us in verse 8, that night there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby. guarding their flocks of the sheep. Suddenly an angel of the Lord appears among them. Now think about that. You're just watching the stars, talking, have general conversation, and suddenly, it wasn't like, you know, fade in, fade out. Suddenly an angel of the Lord met, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified. But the angel reassured them, "Do not be afraid," he said. "I bring you good news that will be great joy to all the people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David, and you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth lying in a manger." Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, "Glory in the highest, glory in excelsis Deo, and peace to those with whom God is pleased."
Amen.
For 400 years, God had been silent. But now he begins to speak again. This is the fourth angel's appearance in just a couple of months. The angel had come to Zechariah to announce the birth of his son would be named John, and he would fulfill the prophecy of the old scriptures written 760 years approximately before this angel had come who would announce the one that was coming, the Messiah, the Christ, the anointed of God. Then an angel had appeared to Mary to tell her she would be the one that will fulfill the prophecy that a child would be born to a virgin who would carry this Messiah, this Christ child. And then an angel appears to Joseph, who would become her husband and the earthly father, the stepfather of Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Lord himself. The angel suddenly appears. The skies light up. The glory of the Lord is around him. And we know it had to be a scary event because the angel says, "Do not be afraid." But then the angel refocuses their attention. He begins to focus them on joy. He says, "The joy of the good news is here. The Christ has been born. I bring you good news that will be great joy. Has been born in Bethlehem, the town of David." I mean, what a declaration. What a statement. What an excitement there must have been. I mean, I never really thought about it this way. What's this angel doing? This angel of the Lord is preaching the gospel. Mm-hmm. That's what good news means. Gospel. That's what gospel means. Good news. The angel is proclaiming the gospel. He's evangelizing. And in fact, the angel is saying, "I bring you the gospel." And this gospel is good news, and it can bring great joy to all the people. But we read this, and it's actually a pretty poor translation. You know, in the King James, it says good tidings. See, this joy is not for all the people. The Greek word, which is used here, that says people, is actually the word laos. And laos is where we get the word lady from. It was the word which was used to describe the Israelites. It was a word that meant God's special people. Sometimes in church we say clergy and laity, clergy being the pastors and laity those in the church who aren't the pastors. But that's really not the way it's designed. Those of us that are in Christ are all laity. It's best translated as God's special people. You know, sort of like that of the Israelites. The Hebrew word, with the Greeks translated laos, is actually defined as a people group, a tribe, a nation, all those who are of the same stock and language. All right, so this joy that the angel is expressing is for those who have become God's people by putting their faith and their trust in His Son, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Lord, the Savior that this angel is singing about. But then, and here's the, you know, we just read this la la la, but you got to sort of imagine it in your mind's eye. This angel is joined by other angels, but not just a couple of angels coming down from heaven. He's joined by a large number of angels, a vast host, literally translated armies of angels. Suddenly the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, glory in excelsis Deo, and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased." The first stanza of the song says, "Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing over the plains and the mountains in reply, echo their joyous trembles." Can you imagine this? Can you see this? You think about this in your mind's eye. The army of heaven, probably tens of thousands of angels singing together, perfect harmony, angelic voices, and they live in this mountainous area, and as they sing, the echo comes back from the mountains, and it joins in. I mean, this had to be something beyond beautiful to see and hear. The army singing, "Glory in excelsis Deo, glory to God in the highest, glory in excelsis Deo. Glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth with those whom God is pleased." And this peace that we're singing about is actually the word shalom. And it refers to that which was once broken but has now been brought back together again. It is a blessedness. It is a fullness. Jewish people still greet each other, even today, with the greeting shalom. You can wish nothing better for a person than for someone to have shalom. But this shalom is only for those with whom God is peace. Peace is making whole that which was once broken. Shepherds, why this jubilee? Why your strains prolong? What the glass and tidings be which inspire your heavenly song? See, the second stanza asks the questions and the angels answer it. The armies of angels join in and they help answer it. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all the people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, has been born today. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth with those with whom God is pleased." There is good news. The Savior, the Messiah, the Lord has been born. That which was broken can now be brought back together again. Our relationship with God, a holy God, has been broken. We can no longer stand in His presence because of our sin. But now shalom, the blessedness, the fullness, because of this peace that which has been broken, can now be put back together again, all because Jesus, the Messiah, the Christ child, the Lord, has been born. That is the promise of Christmas. Experience Christmas this year. Experience Christmas here. Not some kind of holiday that man has messed up. The good news of the gospel. Experience Christmas this year. Experience the promise of hope and the promise of love and the promise of joy and the promise of peace. The promise of shalom. But the scripture said it's only for those whom with God is pleased. And our Bibles, these ancient historical letters, these ancient historical documents, they make this statement. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, the author says, "It is impossible to please God without faith." You cannot be pleasing to God. You cannot have this peace, which is for those with God is pleased, unless you have faith. And then in chapter 13, the author writes, "May God work in us what is pleasing to Him." And how does He do it? Through Jesus Christ. Jesus came to bring peace. He came to bring blessedness and fullness through the reconciliation with God. That which was broken can now be put back together again through the Messiah, through the Savior, through Christ who is Lord. Without faith and without Jesus, we can't be pleasing to God, and this peace, this shalom, will not be for us. But with faith and with Jesus, glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth will be ours, because we'll be among those whom God says He is pleased. When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. Come to Bethlehem and see Christ whose birth the angels sing. Come adore on bended knee Christ the newborn King." See, for those of us who've been churched for a while, for those of us that are religious, you know, this can really appear to be very unspiritual, right? I mean, you think about the shepherds' reaction. I mean, they didn't pray. They didn't ponder. They didn't do anything except get excited and take action. You know, we think we got to go through all these things, but when you see Jesus, when you meet Jesus, when you hear about this Lord of ours, it should build an excitement in us. You know, the shepherds could easily say, you know, I would love to go to Bethlehem, but I am a paid hand. I have to be here to watch these sheep. Who's going to do it if I'm not here? You know, I'd love to go, but I'm needed here. They could have been me at times and said, you know, they could have made all kinds of excuses why they don't want to go see Jesus. They didn't do any of that. Instead, they were like the fishermen who will later leave their boats and the tax collector who will leave his tax booth when Jesus called. They heed the call of God. And they're not content just to praise God with their lips. They praise Him by going to Him. They take action by going to see what these angels had spoke of. Think about this. How is the Bethlehem of your heart this morning? Are you excited to see Jesus? Do you go to church or do you think to yourself, I get to go to church? Will you praise Him with your lips but not in your heart? Will you be like the ones that Jesus warned us about? These people honor me with their lips but their hearts are far from me. Or will you take action this morning? Will you seek Him and worship Him? Will you come and see this Christ whose birth the angels sing? Will you take action? Will you come and adore Him? Will you come on bended knee and praise Him? Christ the Lord, the newborn King. Will you sing as the angels sing? Glory in excelsis Deo. Glory to God in the highest. Glory in excelsis Deo. I bring you good news that is great joy to all the people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord has been born today. Glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased. The good news is here. It's right here, right now. The good news has been born in our midst. And it doesn't matter your lot in life. Doesn't matter what you're facing. Doesn't matter what's causing you to doubt or fear or anything else, because Jesus Christ has been born for you. Experience Christmas this year. Experience the good news that will bring great joy and great hope and great love and great peace. You can have peace no matter what your circumstances are, because Jesus, the Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born. Glory to God in the highest heaven. Peace can be yours and peace can be mine if you have this Christ child by faith and faith alone, because God will be pleased with you. Your Savior has been born. He is Christ the Lord. Luke goes on in verse 16, they hurried to the village and they found Mary and Joseph. And there was a baby lying in the manger, just as the angels had said. Now after seeing him, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. And all who heard the shepherd's story were astonished. The Savior came at an unexpected time. At an inconvenient time, in an unexpected place, at an unlikely place, in an unexpected way. But the shepherds didn't let any of them stop that. They hurried to see this Jesus. They hurried to the Bethlehem. They ran. They didn't walk to see Jesus. They were excited to see the Messiah, the Lord, the Christ. And they didn't keep quiet about it, did they? After seeing him, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to him about this child. And I look at my own heart and I say, can I say that this morning? Can you say that this morning? Do we tell everyone about this Jesus that we have come here to worship this morning? I mean, think about it. Their story is just like our story. We think we have to know all this stuff to spread the Gospels. The shepherds were ignorant. They weren't even allowed to go into the temple. They probably couldn't read. But not only could they go in, the only way for them to hear the Gospel was to stand outside and listen or to ask somebody that came to see them. But they didn't let them stop them because they didn't quote Bible verses. They didn't go tell people what they were doing wrong. They simply told them their testimony. They told them what they had seen and heard, and it was personal. And it was changed them. They simply told others what they experienced. They simply told others what they had seen and heard. And because it was so personal, because it was so personal, it was so believable, and it was authentic, and it was personal, everyone around them was astonished. Ordinary people doing more extraordinary things because of what they had seen and heard when they met Jesus. Not because they were educated, not because they had gone to seminary, not because they had read tons of scripture and had it memorized, but they talked about what they had seen and heard. As it was with the shepherds, it should be with us. We should do it the shepherds did and tell people our personal testimony. Tell them how Jesus has changed us from the inside out. We should do as Mary did and keep these things close to our heart and think about them often. But Mary kept all these things in her heart and thought about them often. The shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying, praising God for all they had heard and seen. And it was just as the angels had said. In the book of Joshua, chapter 1, verse 8, Joshua records these words that God gave him. Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. In other words, we should know the Word of God. We should read our Bibles continually, not just one time, but continually, so you can know about God. And then keep what you read close to your heart and meditate on it. Think about it often so that you can know God, not just about God. But I also want to show you one other thing too. If you notice, the shepherds didn't quit their jobs. They didn't run away into the mission field. They didn't go around preaching the gospel and become preachers. They went back to work. The shepherds went back to their flock. Now, God may call you to quit your job. God may call you to go into the mission field. God may call you to be a preacher, but that's not the way He normally does it. Sometimes He wants you to stay right where you are at so you can proclaim this message, so that you can glorify Him, so you can praise Him for all you've seen in others, so other people will be astonished and they will want what you have. This peace, which is for all the people with whom God is pleased. You may be the very person in your workplace that shows people God, and you may be the only person there that does. Shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying, praising God for all they had seen and heard. We are called to be silent when we meet the living God, the Messiah, the Christ, and who is Lord. We're to tell everybody about what we've seen and heard. But folks, this gets so much better. Not only, once again, do we see the sovereignty of God, but we see that we serve this God that always keeps His promises. It was just as the angel had told it. It was just as God had foretold centuries before through the prophets. It was just as God had promised long ago. That means we can experience Christmas no matter what we're going through right now. Because God has promised you and God has promised me, God will take care of you and He will supply all your needs from His glorious riches which have been given to you through Christ Jesus. God has promised you and He has promised me that if we will trust in the Lord with all our heart and do not depend on our own understanding, if we will seek His will in all we do, He will show us which path to take.
That's true.
God has promised us that He has a plan for our lives.
Yes.
And there are plans for good and not for disaster, to give you a future and hope. And in those days, when you pray, God promises you He will listen. God promises you and promises me He will never fail you and He will never abandon you. Experience true Christmas this year because God never breaks His word. He always keeps His promise, and He's promised you and He's promised me hope and love and joy and peace. See Him in a manger laid. With the choirs of angel praise, Mary, Joseph, lend your aid, while our hearts in love we raise. Don't me Jesus in the manger. We see Jesus and he's lying in his manger. He's a baby. He's snugly wrapped in these strips of cloth. It is a beautiful nativity scene. It is a beautiful at Christmas time, but let's not leave Jesus in the manger.
Amen.
Let us not forget that Jesus grew up. Let us not forget that Jesus grew up and lived this amazing life. And then he sacrificed his life for us. And then he rose, or he was resurrected from the dead for us. And then he ascended back into heaven, where he now intercedes and petitions for us. Don't leave Jesus in the manger, because Christianity is not based on the birth of Christ. It doesn't hinge on the birth of a child. It doesn't hinge on Jesus being born. It hinges on his resurrection from the dead. No one has ever changed the world like Jesus Christ has changed the world. Other political leaders have been born and died. Other religious leaders have been born and died. But none of them have changed the world as Jesus has changed the world. Jesus changed the world when he came to live in it. And Jesus should change your world and my world. Jesus should change our world when each one of us sees the Messiah, this Jesus, this Christ, this Savior, our Lord. When you close your eyes and you picture Jesus in mind, do you see a baby in a manger? Or do you see the picture of a living God? Do you see the picture of someone who is Lord over your life, ruling over the heavens and the earth, and interceding on your behalf? When you look at your life, has Jesus changed your world when he entered it? Has he changed the world of the shepherds on that first Christmas night? When you speak of Jesus, are others astonished at what you've seen and heard? Do you see him in a manger laid, whom the choirs of angels praise? Mary, Joseph, lend your aid, with our hearts in love we raise. When you picture Jesus in your mind, do you sing as the angels sang? Glory to God in the highest. Glory in excelsis Deo. Glory to God in the highest. I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all the people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord has been born today.
Amen.
See him in a manger, laid whom the choirs of angels praise. Mary, Joseph, lend your aid while our hearts in love. And I think that's the way we need to end. I think we need to do that just right now. Let's do it right here, right now at the Odyssey Church. Let's be the choir of angels with our hearts in love we raise. So I'm going to ask you, as we close out this series, as we close out this service, to stand with me and let's sing Glory in Excelsis Deo. Angels have we heard on high together, and let's leave here with the good news that brings great joy. The Savior, yes, the Messiah has been born. Glory be to God in the highest. And peace, shalom, blessed in its fullness to those with whom God is pleased. Will you stand with me?
Yes.
Joy and strength.
possible, I do ask you to come out and invite your friends and bring your friends and family on Christmas Eve as we celebrate in song and worship and fellowship the birth of our Savior, yes, the Messiah, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And if you can come, or if you can come, please hand out those postcards and invite people to come. I really, truly think it's going to be a fantastic service. I've heard the practice and the music, and it's a wonderful job. May even have a few surprise singers, and it won't be me, so you're single. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. God bless you. Thank you for being here this morning.